Okay. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 24th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2022. Our first item of business is an evidence session with Colleges Scotland and the Scottish Funding Council. This session will inform our colleges' regionalisation inquiry as well as our pre-budget scrutiny for 2023-24. I would like to welcome Shona Struthers, Chief Executive, and Andrew Whitty, Director of Sector Policy at Colleges Scotland. Good morning. And Karen Watt, Chief Executive, and James Dunphy, Director of Access, Learning and Outcomes from the Scottish Funding Council. Nice to see you again, Karen. We have a lot of ground to cover this morning, so we would like to invite Shona Struthers and Karen Watt to make a short opening statement for a couple of minutes, 2 minutes, if that's okay, before we move on to questions. Oh, Shona Struthers, you have up to 3 minutes.
Okay, I shall speak quickly. Good morning, colleagues, and thank you for the opportunity to give evidence today. We are the membership organisation for all the colleges in Scotland, and I want to convey to you this morning three main points. Firstly, when I look back at the decade that we have just had, which was the start of regionalisation, it was in fact a period of huge change. Between 2013 and 2016, we had the Post-16 Act, which moved colleges into a regional model, making them more accountable and effective through reformed governance, and they focused on giving businesses in the region the skills that they required. The Act also led to the reintroduction of national bargaining. But essentially, alongside regionalisation, there was about 8 or 9 really substantial changes which took place at the same time. So there was a programme of college mergers, moving the sector from 40-plus colleges to the 26 that we have today, operating in 13 regions, 10 single colleges and 3 multi-college regions. Colleges were reclassified as public sector bodies through ONS, and this meant that colleges could no longer carry forward surplus funds. They had to be placed in arm's length foundations, separate from the college. At that point as well, colleges could no longer hold reserves or borrow. So college boards also fundamentally changed at this point, becoming more diverse with student and staff representation, and college chairs publicly appointed and remunerated for the regional colleges and the regional strategic bodies. And we also saw student associations have a new framework introduced. The funding model was replaced. It moved from sums to a credit model. And colleges really did become different organisations with new names, new brands, changes in their culture and new ways of working. There were some very big policy changes around 2014 as well, with the new youth employment strategy from the Scottish Government, the Wood Commission report and the reduction in the amount of international work because of immigration changes. So all of those things together saw a huge change. We also, at that point, saw the first sparks of industrial action because of our introduction of national bargaining. A positive is that since regionalisation, we've had nearly 1 million new qualifications, which I think is something that we should be really proud of as our sector. So colleges manage this enormous volume of structural change alongside the day-to-day work, teaching, supporting students, recruiting, ensuring quality, negotiating with our unions and planning for the future. So that's my first point. My second point, convener, is that we are working in a system that is not thriving, but that still has the potential to thrive. Your colleagues in the Public Audit Committee heard recently from the Auditor General about the significant financial challenges facing the sector. And you have heard evidence on the industrial relations from students, from college principals, on attainment and on the skills landscape. The outcome of the Scottish Government's purpose and principles work is due next year. However, we are not standing waiting for that. We are making sure that we're working on that. So in 10 years from regionalisation, we've had underfunding in the college sector, and it's now very apparent, it's very obvious, and we need that funding to ensure that colleges will deliver for the economy. Finally, convener, my final point, looking ahead, you know that there's a fantastic work that colleges do, but I want to convey to the committee that, you know, we're in a system that is threatened if the funding is not available, or the investment is not available for colleges to deliver. We want our colleges to thrive, and we are willing and able, and we can deliver on government policies, but we need to make sure that we have sustainable and stable institutions to deliver that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Shona. Karen Watt, you also now have up to 3 minutes. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Members of the committee, thank you very much for the opportunity to give evidence to your inquiry about regionalisation and college budgets. I know you've heard from a number of witnesses and you have received written submissions from a wide range of organisations. So I will be brief and I will just focus on three points. First, colleges have demonstrated over the years since regionalisation that they are agile, responsive and flexible. Most recently, in the wake of COVID, colleges showed an incredible amount of determination and creativity to keep students in productive learning as far as possible in hugely challenging circumstances and to re-engage those students who chose to defer their studies. SFC, in its role as the primary funding body, supported colleges in their efforts by introducing flexibilities into our funding, including student support funding, and by providing extra money to make sure students could complete their qualifications through that time. Secondly, colleges play a huge role in reaching those furthest from the labour market and supporting social mobility. In 2020-21, more than a quarter of all college entrants were from the 20% most disadvantaged communities across Scotland, while just over 40% of Scottish full-time first degree university entrants who came from those disadvantaged areas progressed from a college course. And of course, we support colleges to do that. We fund them, their students. We provide over £100 million of public investment targeted in widening access and in inclusion. And we have dedicated initiatives through our Tackling Child Poverty programmes as well. My third point is that colleges are really pivotal to delivering the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. Their contribution to skills delivery is unarguable. For example, through the Flexible Workforce Development Fund alone, they already are engaging with more than 850 employers and 1,380 SMEs. Working with SFC's investment in Scotland's innovation centres and through Intervace, they are developing entrepreneurial people and new market opportunities by bringing together lecturers and industry and business and finding solutions for some knotty problems and current challenges. So, convener, committee members, I hope it's clear from this brief introduction that Scotland's colleges are vitally important for Scotland's economy and social well-being. They are delivering in a very tight fiscal environment and very challenging budget settlements with increased staff costs and inflationary pressures. And we will continue to work with colleges to ensure that they are financially viable and that they thrive individually and collectively and continue to deliver for Scotland's communities. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Karen. Can I move now on to our question session? And I'll kick things off with Graham Day, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I want to explore the issue of the funding model, but before I do that, and just for the purposes of clarity, for the College of Scotland submission, which is very detailed, I appreciate that, talks about a reduction of £23.9 million in the core budget before inflation and rising costs, energy costs in particular, fine, accepted. But it also goes on to talk about the COVID consequentials and comes to the conclusion that a further reduction of £28 million has arisen on its baseline budget, given a total deterioration in the financial position of £51.9 million. But can I ask, were you ever given to understand that the COVID consequential sums would be consolidated in future budgets?
I don't think that we expected them to be consolidated, but I'm happy for Andy to pick that up.
No, we were never given any reassurance or commitment that they would be reoccurring, although, of course, they were spent on items and expenditure that was going to be reoccurring, but we understood them as one-off.
Yeah. So, accepting, as you've just recognised, that it was a one-off, it is inaccurate, isn't it, to talk about a 51 0.9% cut in the budget. A much more accurate description is the 23.9%, 23.9 million, isn't it?
So the positions colleges found themselves in coming out from COVID was that there was costs that they were incurring around mental health, around digital poverty, around foundation apprenticeships, which is what this COVID consequential money was used for, which are still costs that are ongoing. There's still elements that need to be covered. And so if they're not from COVID consequentials, they would need to come from their core budget. And so that would then mean that that money wasn't available to spend on other elements of college provision. And so that is why we do believe it's right to be able to say that that is an effective cut, along with the fact that we didn't get inflation, as you say, the 23 million.
Okay, we'll probably agree to disagree on that point. But moving on to the college funding model, I'm interested to explore the viability of the model in the long term and just how serious the position is for Scotland's colleges, because none of us would want to see the colleges in Scotland get into the financial mess that many colleges have got into in England. So the funding model, how viable is it long term?
I think the way that the model has developed over the years, there has been additional funding put into the college sector, both in real terms and in cash terms, up until the year before last. But at the same time, we have seen our cost base grow way beyond the income levels. And that leaves you running effectively businesses with less and less flexibilities to run it. So you essentially don't have enough income to cover your cost base. I would say some of the things that have exacerbated that have been our huge increase in our pay bill, which is a direct result of national bargaining, which is agreements that are made between employers and union colleagues. And but that has meant that our cost base is now predominantly staff, and the bit that you've got left to pay your legal bills and your auditors and your utilities and so on gets smaller and smaller. So we can't carry on as we are, because there is not enough, and especially when you've got pay awards, as we're seeing at the moment, that just makes that bit that you've got left to run your organisation and to put frontline equipment for students to learn from, that gets smaller and smaller. So we have to address the issue of the ability for colleges to be innovative and to bring in other income streams, and at the same time try and control the cost pressures, which are just growing.
And the SFC, your view?
So if I could pick up the first question about budgets over time. So if you look from a starting point of around 2014, since then, teaching funding has, in the college sector, increased by 126 million. So in cash terms, a 32% increase. If you look at that in real terms, and we would use a GDP deflator, we would say that was about roughly a £34 million increase in real terms, so about 21% over that period of time. Now, about half of that is an increase because of the pay harmonisation process. So you'll find that about £62 million of that was about pay harmonisation and pensions. So what I guess I would say over that time, there has been additional income and funding into the college sector, and that the price, therefore, that we have paid for what we our currency as a credit that we would give has increased by about 29%. So roughly an increase of that magnitude over that period of time, but very specifically for partly for increased places, but also for staff costs. Now, on the funding model itself, we would usually fund on a kind of a volume price activity kind of model. So we would fund for the amount of credits that we were putting into the system. For a little period of time, we almost set that aside in order to pay for the staff costs and the national bargaining. What we now need to do is look at whether that model is right for the future. And I guess that's why we're working quite closely with the sector. It's why we did a national review in 2021. which asked some questions about whether the funding model was right going forward. It's quite complex, and I think simple models are better, but we're trying to deal with a quite complex environment. And so what we have in our funding model is a range of indicators, so things like predicting how many young people are likely to come out of school in a particular regional area, predicting how much in-work activity a college might want to do rather than how much we would fund for young people coming out. So there are a range of local, regional and national indicators that go into it. But I have to say, I think our model is relatively complex at the minute. So we are looking at it and we will look at whether it's quite right for the future.
Can I pick up on the issue of pay harmonisation? Because it strikes me that, particularly in the early days of merger and regionalisation, there was a considerable amount of work done and a lot of money expended bringing pay levels into line. Which, so there's that kind of legacy issue that's contributed to this quite substantially. To what extent is that contributed to the financial difficulties that the colleges face now?
I think it's actually significantly helped in that I think it has increased the value that we attach to the kind of the people who are at the front line of teaching and serving student communities. I think there has been a parity across the college sector. So by necessity, the national bargaining has has enabled that kind of sense of equalisation across the staff base. So I think it has been immensely successful in bringing a range of, equitable arrangements across the entire part of Scotland. The issue for us is it is still true to say that most of a college's costs, if you like, are therefore staff costs. And if you look at that in the round, probably around 68% of college's staff of costs are actually based in their staff costs. Now, that therefore means when budgets get tighter, it is very difficult for a college not to go to that as their place of how do they balance their books and how do they look at their viability in the round. So I think it has been a success. I think it has helped to bring salaries into a very esteemed profession, and I think it has helped across Scotland to make these jobs attractive and well paid.
One final question, maybe, Camille, just to pick up on that point, because we explored earlier in our evidence-taking session this point about up to 70% of some colleges spend is on staff. Just to get the SFC's view on this, given your overview of educational spend, do you think that's an appropriate position that the colleges find themselves in, set against the position in universities and schools education? Is that level of spend on wages justified? Are you comfortable with that?
So I think it is incredibly hard to have an absolute rule about this. I would say it is definitely an indicator that we track because, of course, in times where there is significant public spending, then that is actually it is a positive that we can still see that kind of investment going into colleges. However, when times are more challenging, of course, it's a risk, I guess, that colleges will face. We don't have a set milestone or a set benchmark on this. We simply watch that. And as I said, our average at the minute is around, it hovers between 66 and 67%, but some colleges will be more. I mean, the question then becomes also, how can colleges generate other surplus activity? And would that compensate or would that bring in additional funds? And of course, being classed as public bodies, that is slightly more complicated because while you might generate surplus, you can't always retain it at the end of the year. And therefore, the model in and of itself doesn't lend itself necessarily to that kind of surplus generating activity. So it is a risk, but actually the positive is that the government has supported that kind of staff space and that those costs. Going forward, though, it is clearly a risk indicator for colleges, yes.
I think we need to give Shona Struthers the opportunity to maybe answer some of those points if she wishes to.
I would just make two very quick points about the harmonisation. That's referring to the lecturers. Obviously, with the support staff, we're going through a job evaluation programme, which is still ongoing. So it's where it's appropriate to pay the same money for the same job, then we've done that. And my other point I would make, and it's already been raised at committee, is that it's not just the total income you need to look at and a proportion of staff. It's the amount of money that colleges have to run their colleges. So they get student funding, for example. It's money in, money out. It's the amount of money that colleges have to run their operations, where some colleges are seeing high 70%, nearly 80% of their costs in staffing. And that's where that's far, far too tight for any business to run with that amount of leeway that's not staff costs.
Thank you.
Thank you. Willie Rennie first. OK, thank you.
This is for Karen Watt. I just don't recognise, when you present this, has been an increase in funding in recent years. I would quite like you to repeat from what baseline you're talking about. Because back in what is about 2011, 12, 13, there was a massive reduction in college funding. Massive. What's your baseline for your increase that you just mentioned?
So I've taken a baseline of 2013-14.
Yeah, so that's
no.
Yeah, okay.
You could take a number of benchlines. I've taken that one largely because it's to do with the transfer of colleges into public bodies, and therefore, when we were looking at this, it seemed a rational approach to take to look at that as a baseline. If you look at it from a year-on-year perspective, so if we take like that the budget settlement over the last few years, we have seen an increase in budgets. But again, we will always face a kind of a fairly fluctuating situation. And what we try to do as a funding council is minimise any instability in the system. So, for example, last year, I just make this point to try and set out how we might smooth things occasionally. We did find an additional £9 million, for example, for foundation apprenticeships. Now, that wasn't money that was already in the Scottish Government's baseline to us. We decided to not fund some non-core programmes to put that into learning and teaching, so we can smooth some of the ups and downs of the budget.
Yeah, but in relative terms, that's tinkering. When you compare it with 2010-11. I mean, have you got the comparisons with that year?
Microphone on. Thank you. The amount of public money being spent per college student has dropped by 9% from 2010 to 2012.
I mean, I'd hoped that the SFC would kind of speak truth to power in this, because in part you're the voice of not just the higher education but the college sector. So talking about managing the slight fluctuations from year to year doesn't really represent the massive pressure that colleges are under. I mean, the Derek Smeal, week before, he said there was chronic underfunding, the future includes a potential loss of 25% of my workforce by the end of 2027. Is he right?
So don't misunderstand me. I am not suggesting for a second that the sector isn't under significant pressure. So my point was about public money coming into the college sector to pay significant uplifts in staff and college pay bills over a particular period of time, which led to a significant increase in funds. So the question about whether or not the sector has pressures and is sustainable is a slightly different one. So I would suggest that we look at this in a number of ways. So, first of all, yes, there are massive pressures, and also it is extremely difficult for colleges to manage the fluctuations in the budget. So, over time, we will see some colleges needing to reduce. Now, that may not just be about public funding. It may also be about demographic changes. It may also be what we are seeing as a slightly different demand for example, further education, and the pressures that are coming from some of the competitive angles of young people. There aren't as many young people. Therefore, you've seen a growth in the number of people going into higher education, a growth in the number of people going into universities. So when we're looking at the pressures in the college sector, we are looking at it in the round. Staff costs, pensions, inflation, demographic changes, and trying to work through with the college sector how, what level of activity do they need and what level of funding have we got from government to distribute to support that?
The what you call fluctuations, but the big picture is a massive change in the last decade plus, massive change, where colleges have been diminished significantly. And I'm just not sure we've got voices who are making the case for further education to be, you know, a major part of the education system in Scotland. Let me just, I mean, if you never answered the question about 25% reductions for Derek Smeal. Do you think that's right?
So forgive me for not being specific, but what I would say is we've just had projections in from every single college, and I apologise to the committee, we have not been able yet. It came in at the end of September, so I don't have all of that to hand.
Do you have any of it? Do you have a rough picture?
Well, I have a rough picture that there will be staff losses in the sector.
What, 25%? More?
Well,
less?
So I don't think any college at this point today will be able to accurately predict that. I think what they have is a general trend, and I think you will see some colleges, and Derek's college may be one of those, that's facing significant pressures. There's
absolutely so do you think the 25% might be right for Derek?
I'm not trying to not answer the questions, just I actually don't know I think Derek will have used certain assumptions going into his college, and we're working with colleges just now about what's a realistic set of assumptions to plan for that far ahead. Because right now, we are still trying to work through what will the budget be even for 23-24.
I know Mr. Whitty wants to respond as well,
let me just finish this particular bit. I think what you're saying is that you don't broadly disagree with what Derek's assumption is, and that you're not disagreeing with the fact that there's going to be significant cuts over the next few years. You don't know precisely, which is why you don't want to say, and you're nodding, so I'll take that as a...
I do think there will be a significant challenge for colleges to look at what amount of activity and how they can contribute to that. And I think the government will be looking at its... as I've said on a number of occasions, I actually think the government has already said it's likely to be a flat cash settlement over the spending review period. Now, actually, that's real-term cuts. And actually, that means that year on year, we will still be looking at, is that flat cash, or will it actually be a smaller budget settlement for us to distribute?
OK. I would come back after.
That's fine. We'll see Mr. Whitty, and then you can come back in, Willie.
Thank you, Convener. Audit Scotland have figures reported there's a real terms cut of 9% going into academic year 22-23. And whilst over some of the past few years, on the income side, you could see a small real terms increase, the important thing is to look at the whole cost base. And we've already started touching on some of the pressures of national bargaining and harmonisation of mainly the harmonisation costs. And so the cost base has increased. And whilst there has been significant money put in by Scottish Government, it leaves colleges with a consolidated cost going forward for those for the staff costs, both on the lecturer side and the support staff side. And I was going to make the point that actually Karen just touched on at the end, that looking forward, we've got flat cash laid out in the spending review of May this year, which is an effective cut because of inflation. But we're already seeing revisiting some of that. There's an emergency budget due later this month, I understand. And so all of these predications are on flat cash and the inflationary impact, which of course is huge at the moment. We don't really know where that's going to go. But if there was then further cuts or a revisiting of the budget, it makes it very difficult going forward because of that. And the other element of this, and you'll see it in the evidence that SPICE produced for this session, is just the difference in the cost per head or the price per head that's given to students in colleges, to universities, to other parts of the education sector. So the college funding per head is the smallest that's provided across the education landscape.
Okay. So I've got
small because well, I know I've got a number of subs on that sub.
Can I come back to pace?
Yes. If we go over to these supplementaries and come back to you for that one, Stephen Kerr first, please.
I mean, I'm just going to follow on from Willie Rennie's questioning, because my understanding is that the key to the future economy of Scotland is skills. So, for heaven's sake, what's the impact of what we're discussing going to be, in not just in terms of the college sector, but in terms of Scotland's economy? Shona?
I mean, it's massive. The government is looking for an economy to be revitalised. You need a technical, skilled workforce to deliver that, and colleges are that deliverer. They deliver the skilled workforce. So if you don't invest in the college sector, you don't get your skilled workforce, and your businesses suffer. I mean, for me, it's really, really simple and clear. The investment in colleges give a return, and you get your skilled workforce, and the economy grows, and Scotland grows. So I know that Andy's got some specifics in detail around some of the opportunities that could be lost if we don't invest in these skills.
Yeah, I'd certainly want to hear those.
Okay, thank you. We're all aware of the Scottish Government priorities around the economic growth and a fair economy, around dealing with poverty, around dealing with net zero, and just following on the point that Shona made, that you know the a well-funded, adequately funded college sector is vital to deliver on each of those government priorities. And just to give an example, there's it's the potential lost opportunity costs of not having the capacity to be able to deliver that high-end technical skills that Shona's mentioned. And so these are all publicly available figures, either from the industry themselves or from Scottish Government itself. So the offshore wind industry, when we're starting to look at net zero, starting to look at the economy, the offshore wind industry projects investment of £6.3 billion per year from now to 2035. So that's £95 billion with 40,000 potential jobs. That's to deliver 30 gigawatts of power. There's a further 10 gigawatts of power being planned on onshore. With hydrogen, Scottish Government predicts 10,000 to 40,000 jobs by 2045. In transport infrastructure, there's £9 billion of investment by 2026, so just in the next few years, with 25,000 skilled workforce just to replace those who are going to retire or leave the industry, not to then build the industry to where it needs to be. There's £33 billion of investment in energy efficiency, low carbon heat. So there's risk that Scotland doesn't maximise these opportunities of this investment if you haven't got a college sector that can provide the skilled workforce that's needed in these areas. And so the lost opportunity cost of not funding adequately the college sector going forward is huge, not just for individual learners, but also for communities, but also for Scotland's economy. So for helping deliver one of the key priorities of the Scottish Government around net zero and the economy, then it's vital that colleges have that ability to be able to deliver the skilled workforce, that high technical end workforce that predominantly is going to be delivered to the colleges.
Is it? So, you know, we had Kate Forbes's economic plan, the transformation plan, which, you know, on the face of it, is a very exciting prospect. But what you're basically saying, Shona and Andy, is if the college sector continues to be on the receiving end of these cuts, including this flat cash settlement that's projected going forward, that it's an impossibility to deliver on that plan without the college sector being invested in, as opposed to being disinvested in, which is what's happening currently.
That would be, thanks, Convener. That would be my view, and I think the element around NSET, National Strategy for Economic Transformation, is that there's five themes in that, five pillars in that, and the obvious one that your eye is drawn to when you mention colleges about the skilled workforce, but actually colleges are needed to deliver each and every one of those pillars, not least the entrepreneurial landscape that is needed and required, not least the productive businesses. So 44% of learners in a college have an industry link as part of their course, for example. So that importance of the college sector for delivering that link to business is key, and for opening up those new market opportunities, again, one of the key elements of NSET.
And Shona, do you agree with my use of the word disinvestment?
I think that the government does invest in the college sector, and
negatively, though, apparently.
So the flip side of that, if it doesn't invest in the college sector, then there will be consequences to that, and the college sector will not be able to help the government deliver its economic strategy and its net zero strategy.
But the current projections are hardly an investment, are they?
So if the investment is to go down, I mean, you have heard some principals talk about reducing their staffing cohort.
Yep.
Every college is looking at how it can balance its books. It's in the public sector, they have to balance their books. So if every college is looking at how it has to restructure, take costs out, take staff out, that means the curriculum.
Well, that's
impacted,
not investment, is it? It's retrenchment.
And the students are impacted.
Yeah. So, okay. Well, it's very clear.
Thank you, Stephen. Bob Dawes, you've got a supplementary on this theme, or
yes.
Is it?
Yep. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Convener,
it's specifically on the exchange in relation. I think it was Mr. Whitty who spoke about the disparity of funding between colleges and universities, and the discussion has been around a real terms cut to the college's budget. And of course, there's a projected flat cash across the entire further and higher education sector. But University Scotland came to this committee the other week, asked for an additional £171 million. And Mr. Whitty's already said that he thinks the funding landscape is not equitable between colleges and universities for those early years of a university degree that's often carried out in a college environment, with 43% of all young people from a deprived background.
Can we come to the question,
in universities,
please?
This is really important. In universities, going through the college sector, but getting less funding for it. Does Karen Watt from the Funding Council want to see more about that? And does Shona or Andrew want to see more about that? Because if University of Scotland are coming here saying, give us £171 million more, without having any clue where the cash is coming from, and colleges are coming here saying, we'll just do our best in a tight financial environment,
thank you,
should you not stand up for colleges?
Shona first, perhaps, or
I don't recall
Karen
saying we'll just do our best with what we've got.
Yeah.
What I'm making a plea for this morning is for the committee to see the great return on investment that colleges are, and to ask for that investment. That's what I'm saying. In terms of the funding per head for universities and colleges, I can provide that to the committee in writing. It is a Scottish Government table we're talking from, and colleges are the least funded per head of student from preschool to university. So why should college students be less funded than anybody else in the education system?
So in a fixed-sum budget, should money be taken from universities and given to colleges to have that equity?
I'm not advocating that at all.
Thank you. Karen?
So there's quite a lot in that. So just first of all to say, the government is still investing through us £675 million a year for college students to be supported. And every year the college sector has met that target of 116,000 full-time equivalent students going through and being successful in a variety of different ways. So I don't want to lose the fact that there is a significant amount of public funding going into colleges, and they are successful, and they deliver, and they keep delivering. Now, the question about parity of funding is a complex one. So let me just take a couple of strands of that. First thing is to say that when we look at funding for different institutions, colleges and universities, we look at a number of different things, including their different cost bases. So universities, for example, and a lot of universities, are simply more, have a different cost base and are more expensive. They have different kinds of infrastructure. They have high-cost medical clinical facilities. They have larger library collections. They have, for particular provision, they have much smaller classes where they have specialist and quite focused tuition. Now, therefore, historically, what we have been doing is compensating slightly for that quite different cost base. Colleges, again, are all quite different. So some colleges will have a higher cost base. They will have more technical facilities and they will run in a different way. But in general, the cost base is not quite the same. Therefore, we have a slightly different funding arrangement for those first-year undergraduates and, for example, people going through a higher qualification at college. Now, we did explore this in our national review. Should we change the funding model to, for example, follow SCQF levels? So should we fund those students who are going through a higher national qualification at a college at the same level as the first 2 years of undergraduate, roughly speaking? Now, again, I think that is part of the conversation for the future about, is that something we should do? Now, what we don't want to do is pull down the funding from university undergraduates to do that. But again, it's something we are exploring and we're willing to explore that more fully as we go through this funding review model. That being said, we are still going to probably have a smaller pot to distribute. Therefore, we will have a really difficult choice about how much increase we could put into that level of funding per college student compared with others. But it is, at the minute, it's a recognition of the different cost bases, and it is an efficient use of public funds. And it is not the same, for example, around parity of esteem, because those kind of parity of esteem issues are probably much broader than just the funding model. But we are absolutely open to looking at that in the future.
Right, thank you. Can we go back to Willie Rennie, as I said we would do?
So we've heard that there's big cuts coming for the college sector over the next few years. But we heard from Hugh Hall from Fife College 2 weeks ago, where he said that we're not able, even in those circumstances, to determine our own future because the government can't make up its mind. So he set out the case. The Coherence and Stability Review report was published in June last year. The minister responded in October, but they're going to have to wait until summer 2023 before they get the statement of intent from the government. Why is it taking so long?
Probably a question for government, if I'm being honest. But
to them about this.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I think what they're keen to do is have enough consultative time to work with both college and university sector about quite a complex set of how do you set out exactly what you want for the public money that you're investing.
But 2 years.
That being said. We did publish our national review in 2021. It was quite detailed. It was based on a lot of insights that we gathered from colleges and universities. And we hope it is useful to government in coming to their conclusions about things. The other point I would say, though, is we are not waiting for some of that broader policy and principles work to continue to do the implementation of the review recommendations as they currently stand. And I would also argue some of our recommendations to government in our review are utterly germane to the stability of the sector. We were very clear. We think it matters that colleges have multi-year planning assumptions and some certainty about budget. That in and of itself is probably one of the biggest issues about how a college can plan for its future. So that was part of our recommendation. And we have also made a number of recommendations about engagement with employers, where we would like to see government bring together disparate, different strands of programmes to invest properly in an employer engagement set of programmes for colleges again. But the best answer, I guess, on why it is taking so long is the government is trying to be consultative and open about and taking a range of views before they come to a decision on this.
You're smiling halfway through your answers there, and I suspect there's a bit of frustration from yourself. If you can get on and make an awful lot of the decisions following the review, then I can't quite understand why government, especially when the college sector is under extraordinarily pressures. So, what do we do about this? Why can't you relay to government that colleges want to get on and plan?
I think we are. I mean, we are collectively working through a range of things, including the speed at which that intention is articulated, how we can influence. And to be honest, we are also working on a number of other things which don't require that. So, for example, the College Capital Programme is subject to co-creation and co-work with the sector. So we are doing a range of things. We are very clear it would be good to have that intention quickly enough for it to influence spending decisions within the spending review period.
Shona, would you like to?
Yeah, I can tell you that last month and this month we've had all the chairs and principals across Scotland together, Chatham House discussions about what do we do, how do we come up with innovative solutions. So the government, we are working with the government on the principles and purpose work, of course we are. We are also moving at speed because this is urgent.
Okay. Thank you very much. Can we move to questions now from Michael Mara? Thank you.
Thank you. I mean, you talk about consultative review, Karen, in response to Willie Rennie's question. The college principals we've had in front of us said they don't have a clue what's happening with this. Who are the government consulting with?
On the supposed
statement of intent?
My understanding is that they are engaging with College of Scotland, University of Scotland, with a range of other stakeholders. I don't think it has got to the point where they have something written in a form that is being formally consulted on. They have some draft material that they're sharing before it becomes more widely publicised.
Okay.
That's our understanding as well. So we have had some workshops with Scottish Government officials, with VP level. We're currently arranging one for with principals and with chairs to continue that discussion. That was actually due for the 12th of September, but unfortunately was cancelled due to the passing of the late Queen. So that did impact actually when we were going to be meeting.
Four college principals in front of us, I asked this question directly of them 2 weeks ago, and they all said they had no involvement in it whatsoever. I mean, it doesn't really feel like proper consultation. There's nothing written down. Anyway, I want to move back to, if I want to move back to finances, if I may. I mean, I'm glad that things have, I appreciate your most recent comments on that and answers, Karen Watt, because I feel that at the start of the session we were a little bit indicating that the challenges seem to be about national bargaining, you know, rather than actually the overall reduction. I wouldn't like it to come out from this committee that looked like, you know, greedy staff were taking up the, you know, we have to recognise there's been a very significant reduction in resource from government to colleges over the last decade. And I think that that's come out a bit more strongly in recent answers. But I want to ask about, you've been asked to do more. So we had the SQA in front of us a couple of weeks ago, and they said that colleges are very well placed to make up for lost learning, the significant lost learning in our schools. I mean, that's another headwind, isn't it, for colleges, Shona Struthers, to make up in terms of the weight that's been added to colleges whilst there's resource being taken out.
Yeah, I mean, I think colleges are many things to many people, which is part of what makes them so unique and so required and necessary in our societies, is that they lean into schools and they work with businesses and apprenticeships, and they encourage people to go on from college and into university with articulation and so on. So there are many different facets to colleges, and the point that you make there is just one of them. We also have a large cohort with assisted learning needs. So colleges are quite complicated in that they have a lot of different
different markets, but at the end of the day, it's your technical, professional, vocational, skilled workforce that comes out from it.
But these are young people who have had less learning in school over the last couple of years, and the SQA are telling us that colleges should make up that gap. Is that what's been experienced by colleges across Scotland?
So what colleges who, because our members are reporting to us about loss of learning is on two elements. There's firstly within the colleges themselves, where particularly the practical subjects that people weren't able to be in, the learners weren't able to be in, and some of those deferred, but the colleges have worked really hard to see a high percentage of those returned and return and to get the qualification. We're also seeing loss learning from school pupils coming in to the colleges. So what colleges report is increased mental health challenges with some of those pupils coming in, and also some challenges around social interaction, where some of these people have missed out on that face-to-face social elements within school. And so, you know, I think broadly across society that rise in mental health challenges, we see that reflected in colleges as well.
Okay. And those, I think that adds to some of your previous answers around the opportunity costs, so other pressures that are coming to bear. Given what we've heard then about 25% cuts to staff, you know, in some colleges, and I take that we're not going to get firm figures on that. I mean, I think the committee would appreciate if there was some form of feedback from those written reports that Karen Watts received from the colleges. Is it likely that the sector will look anything like it does now in 3 years' time, given these challenges and also the funding cuts that are coming? Karen, what?
So first of all, I do actually think the college brand is extremely strong, and I think there is still an appetite in a lot of communities for kids to go to college. So I think that is a hugely important driver around this. But if we were looking longer term at a recipe for financial sustainability, you might have a number of different things in there. And one of the big benefits, I think, from regionalisation has been you have now got colleges of scale. You have got colleges that are around different tables, different planning tables, different engagements. And what I think our review last year described where possibilities around different relationships, not just between colleges, but with universities. So I think what we might see over the next few years is a closer amount of collaboration on student journeys, on joining up curriculum, taking out potential duplication from some of the courses that might be there at the minute, and making sure there's a better set of pathways for people right through from school, college and into university. And we might even see, as we are having some very, very early discussions at the minute, about partnerships between colleges and universities that get into conversations about have we got the right organisational structure to make ourselves viable and strong for the future. Now that's just one element.
Mergers, possible mergers is what you're describing.
I'm not even talking about the M word. I am more likely to...
Why are you averse to the M word?
Well, I'm not averse to mergers, because actually regionalisation was about successful mergers. But I guess I'm suggesting there might be a menu of things that might shape the way the college sector works. I always think there will be standalone colleges that are vibrant in some areas. I think, for example, in some of the multi-college regions, we will see some differences emerging. We are already, for example, seeing three colleges coming together on their own volition to merge to create a stronger, more viable entity.
Describing there was possible mergers between universities and colleges, wasn't it?
I think I suppose I'm looking at the kind of conversations we're having just now. Colleges are exploring different kinds of relationships with universities, not necessarily mergers, but more closer alliances, looking at efficiencies in the way services are delivered to some students. Some of that might look at different kind of entities. Now, you can't really merge a college and university at the minute, given the statutory basis that we have. But if there was an appetite for that from the sector, we would clearly look at how might one think about that over time. It would challenge legislation, funding models and everything else. And
it's quite
would
clear
not
there's...
be appropriate for every place.
Michael Marrow, you did ask about what it might look like in the future, and I think that's what Karen is going down that avenue as well.
I think it's very useful, though, convener, because I mean, this is an area that I think hasn't been particularly well explored or exposed. As far as I can tell, there's no appetite in the sector for mergers with universities and colleges. I certainly think it would be very, very difficult. Mm-hmm. Is this something that government is keen on looking at?
No, I think when I say we are having some discussions with different stakeholders in the sector, they're taking what we suggested in our review from last year. So when we published our review, we talked about different forms of collaboration along a spectrum. And excuse me, that might involve collaborating on particular projects where you could get better value for money. It could be around innovation projects where you're looking at that flow of skilled talent or equipment or better use of the infrastructure that we have already invested in universities, innovation centres, interface places like that. Or it could be different kind of relationships about in a loose kind of federation. So we have mentioned in our review a range of different possible options for the future, but that, of course, is also based on how do we strengthen colleges as they currently stand.
I mean, Shona Struthers, maybe bring you in on this, on what Karen Watt calls the M word, and whether there is that a word, the M word, that's been used in the sector? Is it something the sector's fearful of or welcoming of?
I was just nodding to the convener to come in. I mean, when I speak to many of the college principals and chairs, what I hear from them is their discussions with other institutions. And I know that many of our colleges are in deep discussions with universities for different courses, for different ways of working. And I think that's really healthy, because if you've got the student at the heart of this, a really clear pathway for a student who may come into college with an expectation that that's the end of their journey, to then see an opening that allows them to go on and finish their education at university, I think that's a really healthy thing. So I know a lot of our principals and chairs are speaking to all sorts of institutions. They're speaking to businesses about setting up bespoke skills academies and so on. So I think that just shows the reach that colleges has and what their aspirations are for our students, which is to take it as far as they can in terms of their skills and their qualifications.
So I know that a lot of that work has gone on. So, for instance, Aberdeen is one of the areas being cited, the relationship between RGU and the local college. But I know, speaking to both those organisations, merger is so far off their agenda, and they see a huge cost in that. But they're one the more advanced. So where does the merger issue come up?
I think mergers cost a lot of money as well. When you look back at, somebody's, regionalisation, there was a lot of mergers took place at the regionalisation point. It cost a lot of money. There is a merger going on in the college sector right now in the Outer Hebrides. So there are some changes still happening. And actually, I think it's really healthy if a sector, the college sector, does evolve and change, because that means we're not standing still.
Thank you very much. We're going to move on now to some questions from Ross, please, if that's OK.
Definitely. Thanks, Convener. A couple of questions around industrial relations. So for Shona and Andrew, in the first instance, I'm sure you've seen in previous sessions as part of this inquiry, I've asked witnesses why they believe we've had industrial disputes in 7 of the last 8 years within the sector, and we don't have that in any other sector in Scotland. So in the first instance, would you like an opportunity to comment on that? What do you think has brought us to the point where this has become essentially an annual occurrence?
Yeah, thank you for that opportunity, Ross. I mean, what I'd say in my opening statement, I hope conveyed to you the very many serious and significant changes that happened simultaneously at regionalisation. So national bargaining was not regionalisation. It just so happened to be part of the Act, and it happened at the same time. And I think because of all the significant changes happening at the same time, perhaps certainly from the employer's perspective, there was a lot around national bargaining that the planning perhaps wasn't in place at the very beginning. Having a vision, having a strategy, having clear funding, having clear outcomes. And what we've done is we've evolved as we've gone along. And I think that's probably, with hindsight, unfortunate, because I think those that suffered the most were the students. The strikes that took place during exam time, I think it was very hard on the students.
But what you do have now is a system that's it's set up where the employers and the unions come together and we negotiate, and we try and negotiate with clarity about our funding envelope, because it's really important that you negotiate within your means. And I think we've got a healthier position now at a national level. I'm not going to talk about the local level because I'm not close enough to that, but certainly at the national level, things are improving. And we have quite a lot of successes that we can call on in terms of negotiated pay agreements and terms and conditions changes, etc. So we're a few years down the line, and it's certainly better than it was, but it's something that's here to stay, and so we're working hard to make a success of it.
I recognise on one level that statement that things have improved, because I've been involved to various extent over most of these years, but even with improvements, we've still seen national industrial action in almost every one of those years, every one of the last few years. So his question back is, if things are improving, why is there still national strike action every single year?
I think it's unions, workers' rights to go on strike, and so that you have to respect that. It's also incumbent on employers to make sure that they make an offer that's a viable offer as well. So I think I think both sides are coming to the conclusion that you have to consolidate, and you have to come together and find common ground, because going on strike or not making offers that are seen to be realistic isn't in anybody's interest, least of all the students. So I think there's definitely been learning on both fronts. I mean, there's a government Strathesk report, which I know is due out relatively soon, and in there the employers have accepted all of the recommendations for that, so we're looking forward to just making as much of a success of this as we can, mindful of the funding envelope within which we operate.
You've mentioned the latest lessons learned report, and obviously publication of that still to come. Taking both that, but also any internal reflections within Colleges Scotland, are there further changes that you would like to see to the NGNC framework? Is there anything structurally about this process that you think can be improved? Because some of the evidence that we've received, and also a lot of the kind of wider public discussion around this, comes back to, frankly, challenging interpersonal relationships between people who've maybe been in the room on both sides for so long that issues have become entrenched. That's a cultural issue that there are ways to resolve. Are there any structural issues about the process that you think could result in improvement?
On that point, I think the employers have had much more of a turnover of negotiators than perhaps our union colleagues have. One of the things that springs to mind would be the introduction of an independent chair for the NGNC. That is something that we would welcome. It's been a chair that's been rotating between both sides, and we do think that independence might allow issues to be solved more amicably and perhaps quicker than they currently are. So that's something that we would be recommending as part of the government's lessons learned.
Thanks. And on the issue of pay specifically, recognising entirely that this would not free up the money required for the settlements claimed by the lecturers or support staff unions, just because it's the scale is totally different. But do you think there's an issue in terms of urging unions, urging college staff to show pay restraint when there are a number of principals in Scotland who earn more than the First Minister and quite a number who earn more than the Cabinet Secretary for Education?
I mean, I think negotiations, certainly in the NGNC, are two-way. It's the employer puts their case forward, the unions put the case forward on behalf of the staff they represent, and you have to have a negotiation on that. I think the negotiations are definitely improving. I think there is more respect being shown, and also we've introduced the accountability and the financial accountability into that discussion to make sure that both sides are cited on the financials, so that when you are making an offer and whether it's accepted or not, you can see whether it's clearly affordable or not. So I think you have an NRPA, you have a negotiating machinery in place, and I think with the time that's going on, it's just improving each year.
that felt like a bit of a sidestepping the issue of principle.
Well, principles are not part of the negotiating machinery, so you can't confuse the two aspects. The negotiating machinery negotiates on behalf of those staff when there was a local level, they were negotiated by the college and they got moved into the national. So that's who is negotiated for. The senior staff are not part of the NRPA and they're not negotiated for.
No, but you can understand surely why the workforce find it hard to stomach messaging around pay restraint from individuals who are on more than 150 grand a year. Some far more than 150
well,
grand a year.
I mean, I think boards of management have a governance responsibility and the payments that are made to senior staff are in the public domain. So I think that responsibility lies with the board and I think they take their duties very seriously.
One very brief question on the question of boards. There's a long-standing government commitment to enable permanent trade union representation on boards. Like some boards have already got that, but for the sake of consistency, there's a government commitment there. Just to check, is College of Scotland's position in support of that? Do you think that would help improve things?
It's already in place, to my knowledge. We've got two trade union representatives. The legislation hasn't gone through yet, but the two trade union representatives are on boards alongside staff representation as well and student. So I think that makes for a healthy board as well, because you've got all views fed in.
And just one final question on boards. You might be aware of the evidence that, I mean, Derek's already been mentioned, but you might be aware of the evidence he gave specifically on this. Is there a College of Scotland view on the Glasgow Regional Board? Do you align with some of the views that have been expressed to us already, that it's pretty hard to justify why that actually exists at all?
So College of Scotland is the representative body for all colleges in Scotland, and so we take the members' views and we put forward what would be a collective view. Where you have varying views on something, College of Scotland would not be able to land on a specific view because there's variations, so College of Scotland does not have a view on that.
Appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Well answered, Shona. Very good. Now, can we move on to some questions around completion rates? And we're going to start this section with Michael Mara, please.
Thanks, Convener. So the rate of completions, students not getting to the end of their qualification, I think is a matter of concern, not just for this committee, but I know that the Public Audit Committee have expressed concerns to us as well around this. So we're looking at just under a third of students are failing to complete their course. Obviously, that figure is higher for those in deprived backgrounds, higher again for students with disability, and significantly higher for students who've been through the care system. So given the financial settlement we're looking at, how can we see those outcomes improving for these young people? I'll start with Karen Watt.
Thank you. No, it is an area of constant attention and some concern in some college performance. It is extremely difficult, I would say, though, to look at the data that is around the pandemic. So the figures that we're looking at, and of course, we collect this data on an ongoing basis, but some of the figures, not all of them, but some of them relate to that period in time when we were just going into some significant restrictions and where some practical elements of study could not be completed. So there were some issues about how we compare data from the pandemic and the pre-pandemic outcomes. Now, so I think some of the qualifications that students have managed to achieve is actually a testament to how colleges have worked through the pandemic period. So I think if you were to look at the difficulties of making sure that people who are often studying practical subjects got to complete them, then we did a lot with colleges to make sure that that happened. So even from some of those...
I think we would acknowledge the challenges and certainly the great work the colleges did in that period. But these figures are worse for the pandemic period, but they were pretty bad before the pandemic as well. So if we can move into that area,
yes,
I'd appreciate
of course. So I think what we're looking at is, first of all, when we look at completions and quality, we are working with Education Scotland that look at the individual performance of colleges, and there will be a report which I can make sure the committee gets, which should be coming out in the next week or so, which will look at their visits to individual colleges, what they have found, which will go into some of the issues about what they found around particular performance indicators. We are also about to conduct a thematic study where we're going to take what we perceive to be some of the poorer performing colleges alongside some of the top performing colleges and look at some of the issues that lie behind them, because what we think we need is greater explanatory power about what's going on behind those figures.
There's, in the figures, there appears to be a significant gap between small colleges, which have a better, still not fantastic by any means, completion rate, and larger colleges, which have a poorer rate. Given that you've just talked about the M word and possible bigger institutions, you know, and that might be a trend, is that not something that would concern you? Students being lost in, yes, in that process?
Of course, and I suspect that you might be able to get a more personalised approach in certain college settings. That being said, some of the bigger metropolitan colleges will be dealing with communities that have more concentrated disadvantage, and they may well be operating in a context where there is greater competition for young people, to put it like that. So you may well see some students who might ordinarily have been going through a college or going to university or going into a higher national qualification. Therefore, there may well be an argument that some of the students that are now coming into further education courses may well be from areas that are more disadvantaged. They might have less cultural capital. They may struggle sometimes about the choices that they are making. And also, I think we need to challenge ourselves about the way we collect this information. So, for example, a young person comes through the door of a college and they get on a course and they decide, actually, after a few weeks, it's not quite for them. And in our system, we are good at supporting that young person to take another choice. And actually, that really matters. It matters that they have the opportunity, they've tried something, it's not quite right, and you will find a college wrap around that person to suggest they might try and think about these other options that are there, keeping them in some kind of productive learning environment. Now, for our stats, that may well look like somebody has started a course and has dropped out from it, and we will count that in a particular way. So when I say we need greater explanatory power, what I think we are challenging ourselves through this thematic study is to say, are we quite collecting the right data in the right way that allows us to get a better handle on, is that actually a dropout, or is that somebody who's making different life choices and a college is helping them explore a different, more successful pathway?
I think that's very useful. Andrew Whitty?
Yes, thank you. So first point I'd make on this is that we take it very seriously, this issue. I think there's two elements to it. There's one nuance around the statistics. And so I do want to make the point we need to be aware of and careful how they're collated. So if somebody, I think you've heard this evidence previously from some of the principals, if somebody attended a course for an hour and then moved on, they're recorded. If they switch to another course, as has been said, or if they leave for work, that actually impacts the figures negatively, even though that could be a positive destination. So that's one point, just to be aware of around that. But there is work to be done on this. The thematic study that Karen outlined, I think, you know, we would support that because we need to understand what the issue is and what's causing it so that we can find out what the solutions are to it. I would make the point that for many young people, it's about the journey that they've travelled by that individual. And so in looking at this, in what comes from this, what may be introduced or what policy changes are made as a result of any of that study, we do want to ensure we don't have an unintended consequence of colleges impacting their recruitment decisions. So they only recruit people that they know are going to pass, because one of the key cohorts, and it's just one cohort, but one of the key cohorts colleges help are those most vulnerable, those furthest from the workforce, those that have taken a step forward on their personal journey as a result of being at college. So we need to be careful there's not unintended consequences. So, there was a smaller increase in the dropout in HE courses than FE courses as well. So I think there's some nuance around that we need to be careful of when we're looking at all of this. But all of this points, for me, that it needs a cross-agency solution. This is not just in the gifts of the colleges to solve, but actually it needs that cross-agency look at it in order to solve this.
That's very useful. And my final question is relating. The committee struggled in this area for a little while around comparisons to the rest of the UK. And Spice have produced some information for us in terms of, so the nearest comparable figure, and the system is very different, I think we all recognise that, the nearest comparable figure for completion rates in England seems to be 89%. So will some means of comparison go into that methodology that you're talking about, Karen Watt, in terms of production of it? And do you have any reflections as to why that gap, perceived gap, real gap, might be so big?
So, yes, we will be looking at how do we benchmark? How do we know? And that's not just within peer group, but nationally, and as you suggest, we look at other indicators across the rest of the UK. I think, I mean, I don't get unduly technical about this, but we do have a range of technical things that lie behind how we make up these indicators, including whether we're talking about people who leave a certain college leavers as opposed to people who qualify and therefore go on to positive destinations. So I think we need to look at all of these definitional issues. But yes, how we set benchmarks is going to be incredibly important to understand where does improvement really need to lie and what are the contextual factors that we take into account.
Thank you very much, Michael Mara. Now, Ruth Maguire, questions from yourself if you have some.
Was it on that?
We're still on the completion rates,
Rates. So I think you've actually probably covered it, Convener, but I just would wish to say that I think understanding what's happening with students seems key, and I think it's quite troubling that there could be that tension between particularly widening access or adult returners. We surely have to understand why people don't complete, and whether it's for a reason of success that they found good employment or a different course, or whether it's that they're not affording to keep going. So I would welcome that work that's coming.
That's great. Thank you very much. And we have questions for yourself later on, Ruth, as well. Can we now move on to questions from Stephen Kerr around capital funding?
So, Karen, you touched on this earlier, this strategic review of capital investment in the colleges sector. And I've got a couple of questions which I'm sure you'll be able to give me some quick responses on. When can we expect to see the outcome of the review? The autumn?
Yes. And who's been... I beg your pardon, I should just qualify, given that we're going into autumn 23.
That is huge clarification. I was thinking it was imminent.
Well, what is imminent?
Why is it? It's another year.
So what we're doing, right, let me clarify. So what, apologies. So what we're doing is we will publish something soon, which is about how we're actually going to go about developing an infrastructure investment plan, which will be available in autumn 23. So what we're doing over this next period of time is working very closely with colleges about every college will need to revise their own infrastructure plans. So what we had at the minute was a baseline going back to 2017. And what we knew from that time was a funding gap of significant proportions. I'm trying to get the figure. I think it's 300 and at the time, £360 million was required. And that was an estate survey in 2017. What we have been doing is over that period of time, we have had a capital budget of annually, at the minute, it's around £30 million for capital maintenance. And for 22-23, it was £72.6 million overall. And that included capital maintenance. It also included some specific funding for the new Dunfermline Learning Campus. And it was also some digital work. So what we're going to be doing as we put together a more significant infrastructure investment plan is look not just at the maintenance, but at the whole college estate, including digital infrastructure, so that we're looking really holistically at what might be required for the college of the future. Where does estate need to be rationalised? Where are the how do we understand now the needs of a college in going forward. And therefore, we are working very closely, and already have, with colleges about how we understand this, how we get new plans from each college to enable us to understand the nature of the issue now, and then look at the kind of investment that's required and whether there's a possibility of new types of investment that might be available to the college.
Right. So I want to come back to that. There's a very important point you just raised. So what you said is the requirement as it stood in 2017 was 360 million. That was 2017. Yes?
2017.
That was 2017. So do we have any idea what the scale of this is now? I mean, maybe I can turn to...
The 2017 survey identified 360 million over the next 5 years, so that would actually take us to 2022. I think what you've seen from Audit Scotland reports is that the investment has fallen short of that. So historically, there's been underinvestment in infrastructure. Yes, there are some good examples of colleges, and I hope people on the committee have had the chance to visit some of those, and there has been significant monies into the sector for infrastructure, but there are also some very poor examples of a state where there's buckets catching water in areas where learners are having to be taught. But of that 360 million that was identified in 2017, just to be clear, that 360 million was to make buildings wind and watertight. It wasn't to gold plate them. This was simply to bring them to that level of wind and watertight. And I would say so, yes. I think it could be described as that, yes.
And so...
just to make the point that since then... So we'd call that backlog maintenance. So it's maintenance that he's doing. We've received a quarter of that funding of the 360. I think that's the Audit Scotland figures that's in their
assessment
report.
As to where we are now, then. This is going to sound like a much bigger number, I can predict.
Well, what we've also had over that time is there's another type of maintenance called life cycle, which is essentially that needed to maintain a building in its current position. Mm-hmm. And we've had about approximately half the funding needed for that life cycle maintenance. So what that means is that more buildings start falling into the backlog category. So that there is no figure since 2017. The 360 million is the latest.
Do you have any working assumptions about what that number might look like? From the...
I don't have any working assumptions of what that figure is, given that the level of backlog funding and the level of life cycle funding, I would expect that to, well, it will have gone up. I think the work that on the investment plan that Karen mentioned, and you know, we have been working as a sector on the strategy with them. But one of the next stages is actually putting the pounds and pence to that and the investment plan. And I think that's going to be really key to allow Scottish Government to see where the need for colleges fits within, obviously, the pressures they have across the public sector.
So when are we going to see this number?
And just to be clear, when we have invested our capital monies, it has been largely on high priority maintenance and 50% of life cycle costing maintenance. So we distribute our budget to high priority and some of the life cycle maintenance, because that is the money we have to distribute. So what we're doing just now is we're working with the colleges. Every college will need to update its own infrastructure plans, because in order to refresh that information and to do it across the board, not just on backlog maintenance, but on what might be required for the next 5 to 10 years to bring some of the college estate into what you would expect a student walking through those doors should expect to get in terms of digitally enabled net zero strategies. So every college will need to refresh that, expand the information that we get, We will be working with colleges and with other bodies like the Scottish Futures Trust to look at funding models so that when we put together the investment infrastructure plan, it is comprehensive, it is costed, it is clear what the options are for government and others to bring that investment into the college sector.
But what you're describing, would that not be done annually? Isn't this good housekeeping at college level, that they would have an annual inspection, basically, of what they've got and what they would like to have and be able to spec it up and put a number to that? I mean, you're making it sound like it's something they haven't looked at since 2017.
No, that can't be right, surely. No, so some colleges will obviously have survey work ongoing. Some will have survey work on particular buildings or to make sure their life cycle maintenance is being prioritised in the right kind of way. But what we need is a more fundamental look at the infrastructure. So over and above that kind of yearly look at how do you keep what you've got in the right kind of frame of reference. We're not talking about replacing like for like. We're not talking about simple maintenance. We're actually looking strategically at an investment plan across the college estate, working with other partners, looking at where a college is already part of a community plan or a local authority or a school plan, and looking at what does that mean across the piece for net zero targets, digital and the infrastructure across all of the capital investment.
Stephen, could I come in on this, Stephen? Is that possible? Because I'm hearing about all these great, wonderful things you want to do for students, but if the buildings aren't wind and watertight, I think we're in some bit of a critical moment here, that if we've got £360 million needed to make them wind and watertight...
Years ago.
Oh, well, that was... So we don't know now.
I don't even know what
the number is. I'm sitting here concerned that the lack of capital in being provided to our colleges are not giving safe, wind and watertight, warm buildings for our students to go and learn in. So should we not be doing that first before we start... investing in net zero and all those. So I'm just trying to figure out the prioritisation, if you might comment on that. Thanks.
Of course. So every year we spend our capital budget on the high priorities, and that will be where a building is not in a fit state or where there are some urgent repairs that are required. It will also be around critical infrastructure or repairs that a college has identified. But because we have a fixed pot
I get of money, that, I get that, Karen. So we know you're spending money on those things, but we've got. I'm saying is your capital budget is not enough. Is what I'm trying to get, you know, and it's clearly nowhere near enough. And I think we need to be looking and being much more critical around that element of things. Our learning environment is key to completion rates. To businesses coming and working with us, investment all around, the community seeing it as an anchor organisation. It's far more than, so the wind doesn't come through the window. So I just want to...
Completely understand the point, convener. And I think it is true to say that there is a massive mix of estate and quality. And our issue is that is not equitable for every student, therefore. And the point is we do distribute the money to key priorities, and we have some amazing buildings and some wonderful investments, but we would like to see that replicated right across the country.
And those are the buildings that we get taken to for visits. I'm coming back to Stephen Kerr, if that's OK.
Yeah, that's a very good point, actually. So to be able to make those judgments, which you're doing with a finite amount of money, you must know what the current value of the maintenance backlog is. You must have a universal view of what that looks like currently. What does it look like currently?
So I and apologies, I can't give you an absolute figure. As Andy was saying, it is actually very difficult at the minute to do that without some of these new pieces of information coming in. So hopefully we will be able to refresh that view of how much.
Can I ask you to share with us, even if you don't have it today, maybe you could write to us with it.
Of course.
The information that you were working from when you made your last set of allocations.
Yes.
Because that surely would show us very transparently what it is we're looking at. I'm going to move on because I know the convener will want to move on to someone else very shortly. Options, you mentioned several times now, options in terms of
finance to deliver the strategy? What are you specifically thinking of there?
So for quite some time, well, because colleges are public bodies, they are reliant on government funding, and they are not able to build up the kind of reserves that you might need to both reinvest in your stock and to look at the capital requirements going forward. So the first, I suppose the first responsibility must be a government investment responsibility. And that means that we are looking at other strategies that the government has about their Scotland-wide infrastructure, and where we can, we're trying to dovetail with other parts of government to see whether the budgets that are in place for digital improvements or for other kinds of improvements can be used for the college estate. So that's...
So investment back?
Exactly so.
Right.
Now, the problem is clearly the kind of investments that are going into some of these loans are not the kind of investments that are well placed for public bodies. So we're working with we plan to be working with the Scottish Futures Trust about, are there investment models that would allow some different form of investment which could be repaid over a long period of time? To refresh that and see what those might be. Now, at this point in time, I don't think I have the absolute shape of those, but I suppose what I would say to committee is I think we need to explore all possibilities and all
and
options.
One very quick final question, and that has to do with...
Very quick.
Very quick.
And a very quick answer.
That is, there was controversy in relation to the OECD report on curriculum for excellence that ministers had had it beforehand and had materially interfered with the delivery of what was in the report. Disputed as it was.
Sorry, but Stephen, Mr. Kerr, sorry. This was on capital.
No, I'm coming to the point, convener. The point is that will the copy of the review that you're preparing come to us without having been put through any kind of filter in terms of the Scottish ministers?
So I suspect that we will be working with our board, with the sector and with the Scottish Government all along the way to actually create that document, because we will be relying on a sense of what investment might be possible and what the government's commitments will be. But I'm very comfortable about sharing material with the committee as we develop it.
Well, that is reassuring.
Thank you very much. Can we move now on to some questions from Stephanie Callaghan on community learning, please?
Thank you, convener. Andrew Whitty mentioned earlier on about cross-agency work, and I don't know maybe if James or anyone else would like to come in on this. And I think we can all agree that the importance of community learning and widening access is right up there. I'm wondering, you know, there's been a shift towards encouraging students to take up full-time college places. And I'm wondering if that's the best way to improve outcomes for young people from deprived backgrounds and with additional support needs. In part, the reason I say that is because, you know, there are a range of training providers as well that also work with young people who are furthest from the labour market, often with significant personal challenges in their life. And they focus on the softer outcomes, confidence, motivation, self-belief, self-worth, but also on some SQA qualifications too and delivering them. And many of these young people do progress to college, so I suppose are there too many students perhaps struggling to maintain full-time college places because they actually need a bit more preparation before they're able to sustain a full-time college place? Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Every college works with community learning development partners in their area, to help them, as you say, develop those softer skills, which are also some of the skills that the college learners will be learning as they go. I talked earlier about that sort of distance travelled, and for some people, picking up those softer skills, picking up those life skills, those employability skills, is a positive route for them to be able to give them the confidence or the ability. And so colleges will work with the community learning areas around that. I think the the FTE that's been of training that's been delivered, the full-time equivalent training that's been delivered in colleges has been maintained. Indeed, it went up slightly in 2021. And whilst we've seen a drop in the headcount, the FTE's been maintained, and that's related to an increase in longer duration courses. So some of the government policy a few years ago around focused on young people because of the high youth unemployment, and they responded to that, and we were supportive of that response and asking that colleges focused on delivery that led to recognised qualifications. The impact of that was more full-time learners. So that was an impact on that. And whilst the focus was there on young people, colleges never lost wishing and wanting and ensuring they also delivered lifelong learning to people of all ages during that time, even though they were supportive of the focus on young people.
Thank you.
In relation to widening access, as you say, colleges play a really critical role in supporting students from a wide range of backgrounds, including those furthest from the labour market. I think over the period since regionalisation, we've seen colleges become more significant regional players, able to form not just relationships at the level of provision, but also strategic partnerships with local authorities, with private training providers, with universities and employers. And interestingly, on the part-time numbers particularly, there were almost as many part-time learners under 24 in the college sector in 2021 than there were in the full-time equivalent arrangements. I think many of those part-time learners in particular were under 16, so they would have been engaging in college whilst also engaging in other learning, whether that be through school or other arrangements. I think one of the other things I would say in this space is colleges have played a really significant role in supporting our overall ambition for widening access at a tertiary level. And as Karen said in her opening remarks, 40% of those students who go on to university who are SIMD 20 have done so having progressed from a college course. And that is a fantastic illustration of the success of the college sector in widening access.
Thanks very much. You actually picked up on what I was going to ask you about next, about the part-time things. I'm quite interested as well in, you know, what you're saying about community learning and working with training providers and stuff, and the fact that that is ongoing when people are at college. But, you know, there is that difference in the fact that you can get that activity-based learning, group work, outdoor education, and a focus on these kind of things here. So what kind of joint working are you doing on that?
I think much of that working takes place, as you might expect, within the regions, so in those spaces between institutions themselves and local authority partners. Community learning is at its heart about providing what people need locally in order to be successful in their lives and careers, and so much of that scoping of the contribution of the college sector takes place in partnership with local authorities through community planning partnerships and other spaces. The college sector also has a role in providing CPD to staff who work in community learning, and that's an important part of the contribution of the system at that level. More generally, we are really interested in the extent to which the provision we fund is coherent, and through our national review, we committed to not only look at that at a national level, but to pursue a set of regional tertiary provision pathfinders. One of those is in the northeast and the other in the south of Scotland. And in both cases, they're looking at the range of pathways available to learners of all ages and stages, as Andy mentioned, also not just young learners, which have been a particular focus over the period since regionalisation, but of learners who need to upskill and reskill to be successful in their lives and careers.
Thank you. Shona or Andy, would you like to comment quickly on any of these questions?
Just to say, because, you know, through regionalisation, colleges and now, you know, that economy of scale and regional scale and interacting, as James says, with the community planning partnerships and other bodies there, then they're in a strong position to be able to help, and each college will work with the partners around community learning development and that work that's required for their region, and the regionalisation has helped that because of where it's positioned colleges.
Thank you. And I shameless plug for West Lothian College there, who I had a visit to last on Friday, who have a really excellent example of that community anchoring and the community learning. Can we move now on to questions from Ruth Maguire on the reclassification? Thank you, Ruth. Over to you.
Thank you, Convener. Convener, Shona mentioned in opening some of the major changes that the sector had seen, and ONS reclassification was one of them. I wonder if you could tell committee a bit more about the longer term impact of colleges being classified as public bodies, please.
Yeah, thank you. So colleges were brought under ONS reclassified to be public bodies around about the same time as all the changes I mentioned in my opening statement. What that has done is, and many of the colleges tell me that it has constrained a lot of how they operate. So they have to balance their budget. Some of them did have reserves before they were moved into the public sector. So those reserves went into arm's length foundations. So you don't have reserves. Those reserves might have been used for example, capital investment. That's now gone. So you're very reliant on the Scottish Government to provide your capital plan for you. The ability to, if you had reserves, the ability to speculate business-wise, to maybe seed grow some investment in different markets, in different products, international, for example. A lot of that has been constrained because colleges right now are literally struggling to balance their books. So all of that headroom that reserves and the ability to borrow might have given you has been taken away. And I think that headroom that also allows you to be slightly innovative, to be more entrepreneurial, to go out and to bring in other income streams, which colleges still do because no college is 100% funded. But that ability to just be more entrepreneurial, etc., has been constrained, and the headroom within colleges has been reduced. So, our sector is aware that that classification is here. We did, through the Funding Council's review, ask for that to be reconsidered, and the government is clear on their answer on that. So the college sector is working within the constraints of ONS.
So thank you for that. There are flexibilities that other public bodies have. One of your colleges, forgive me, I can't remember who specifically it was, spoke about perhaps even the potential of carrying forward budget. Are there specific flexibilities? I mean, I suppose the being able to use reserves might be one, but what specific flexibilities other public bodies have, recognising that the states might change?
There's different classifications. Mm-hmm. I think the classification that colleges sit in do not allow that flexibility, but I'm happy to defer to.
Shall I pick up just a tiny bit?
Please do. Yes.
I mean, I guess the reclassification and the constraints that bring, fewer cash reserves, the inability to borrow in that regard, and possibly again that long term, how you build up reserves to maintain your estate and reinvest. I think we shouldn't miss sight of the fact that they are also therefore lower risk. So they have less likelihood of having significant financial losses, and they have access to funds to manage their cash flow. So we manage that with colleges on an ongoing basis. And I also wouldn't want to lose the fact that we had very strong representations through our review on this about the fact that colleges are subject to democratic accountability through ministers and this parliament because of the nature of their public body status. When it comes to flexibility, we recommended to government that they explore more flexibilities or push the boundaries of the flexibilities where they possibly could. So we were very keen that we looked at flexibilities around the March financial year end so that we could support more reprofiling towards the end of July, because the college year is longer and therefore it doesn't fit neatly into public body classifications. And it doesn't fit neatly into the way the government manages its books and therefore how we need to work with colleges. So we are The government is looking at those flexibilities just now. I understand that they have prioritised that to consider as part of our recommendations from our review. So I'm hoping that we will have greater clarity for colleges on that in the near future. And one tiny other point is, in England, we are watching very carefully how the ONS is looking at the status of colleges. Now, a number of colleges have gone bust in England and have had either forced recovery or other kind of issues because they're not public bodies. They're non-profit distributing, charitable, other designations. So the ONS is now considering, should colleges in England be put into public body status? And what we're watching very carefully is, will they have any further flexibilities that we could explore in Scotland if that move goes ahead? So we are looking at flexibilities across the piece.
That's helpful. I think it would also be helpful to understand, you know, appreciating the financial challenges that we're all operating under and not diminishing those in any way, how helpful those flexibilities could be and what that would mean for college. It'd be helpful to have that for the record. I don't know who'd wish to.
I think any flexibility for a college at this point in time is very valuable. Whether or not it means they have the full gamut of flexibilities that they might like is probably not going to happen. But any flexibility would make a difference at this point.
Forgive me for interrupting. It's always helpful to know specifics. So I think, you know, we can in general terms say flexibility is helpful. Can you say about what that might look like and what it would mean? What more could be done? Andrew.
The ONS designation is constraining. It's constraining on revenue and infrastructure, just not wanting to repeat the discussion we had a few minutes ago, but that not being able to build up reserves it limits the planning strategically. So I suppose the areas that we want to be able to get to is within what can be done within that envelope, within are there some changes that would allow get to a position where colleges have the ability to plan strategically. I suppose it's trying to get that structure that gives the maximum flexibility for colleges to deliver on all the priorities that we talked about earlier. And so it's looking at and exploring, what could be possible within that. And that has been looked at over the years. As Shona said, the specific designation of colleges is very limiting. But I agree with Karen that we need to see and keep a close eye what is happening in England and what how they may tackle it, and is there things that we can learn from down there?
Thank you.
Thank you. I've got a question on articulation specifically, and whether or not we think that enough progress has been made on the articulation from college to university, and what might be done to encourage further progress. And so, I don't know, just yourself, Shona or Karen. I'm not sure who. James looks
yeah,
like
so,
is the.
So, thank you. Thank you very much, convener. So, articulation has been a key area of national policy over the last decade, and SFC in particular has worked with colleges and universities to drive a focus on articulation that has included, over a number of years, funding articulation hubs across the regions of Scotland, which were collaborations between colleges and universities to drive a focus on particularly the question of advanced standing from higher national qualifications into degree level study. I think through our review we heard a range of voices from colleges and universities which felt that whilst that work had been hugely positive for learners and the system, there was a need for us to think again about the range of ways in which students access provision and become successful through the system. And it links back to the question earlier actually around community routes into and through the system. We also recognise the qualification landscape is changing, and so as part of our review we recommended that we work with students and institutions to develop a refreshed set of access pathways. and a refreshed set of institutional expectations, therefore, to deliver those. This work will take account of the feedback provided by Sir Peter Scott, the First Commissioner for Fair Access, who will shortly demit office, and it will also engage in the work being led by Professor Hayward on qualifications and assessment. The point in this is to bank the progress that has been made in articulation, but also not to lose sight of the range of qualifications that learners use to access and progress through the system. And our broader set of fair access pathways will present us with that opportunity to set expectations across the qualification landscape instead of, as we've seen in articulation, focusing particularly on the HNC, HND into degree level and route.
Okay. Does anyone else want to come in on that? Can we move on? We're okay to move on? Now, we've got specific questions from Bob Doris on Glasgow area, if you don't mind. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much.
Concise.
I'm conscious that the Scottish Funding Council has made some recommendations in relation to the Glasgow College's regional board and the three assigned colleges about how they could work closer together and how structures could be changed. I'm also conscious that Derek Smeal gave evidence to our committee a few weeks ago talking about the Glasgow College regional board has been highly transactional in its activities and massively duplicating the work of the Glasgow Colleges group, who I think he felt another two colleges were lockstep together, thinking was a much more effective strategic way of taking themed activities in the college sector in Glasgow forward. So I'm just wondering, given the Scottish Funding Council made some recommendations in relation to Glasgow Colleges, the government accepted those recommendations and the clear of the three Glasgow College principles is out there, where we are with that and whether the future for Glasgow College Regional Board is maybe is well-intentioned duplication. It might. We had merger earlier on, perhaps we could have no Glasgow College Regional Board. There could be a cost saving in relation to that.
So we did make recommendations to government on all the multi-college regions, the three multi-college regions. In Glasgow, we said huge progress had been made and there had been a lot of very good joint work, but there were mixed views about how well GCRB as an overarching board had had worked, and the time was right to actually look at that again. So in the intervening months between now and our review recommendations, GCRB itself has been looking at a number of different options. We decided to draw a line under that and to work with GCRB on a smaller number of options, which we're just appraising at this point in time before we make a recommendation. Now, one of those options may well be that GCRB doesn't exist going forward. If it doesn't exist, we would still want a number of very, very important principles to pertain. So we would still want one door access for students, so it was uncomplicated about how they accessed college provision in Glasgow. We would want really strong collaboration across the three colleges, and we would want to make sure that ultimately that kind of regional perspective was being taken jointly. So that's one of the options that we are definitely looking at. And I think it's a little early at this stage, but by the end of this year, we will be making a recommendation to ministers about next steps with the Glasgow region.
I ask then where the Glasgow Colleges group sit within that process, because I know there are representatives of the colleges on the regional board, but it was unclear whether principals were actually members or they did attend meetings. And there was a great area about the influence that each college had within the regional board. So where does the Glasgow Colleges group sit, and how can they influence that process?
Yes, I mean, we have heard a number of very strong views about how this should work, but the colleges themselves, there is a view that actually that the college principals themselves not being on the board of GCRB is a difficulty. They observe, their chairs are part of that, so the colleges are represented within that overarching board. But again, that's one of the things we need to look at. What is going to make better outcomes happen, and what is a what is the best governance arrangement to make that happen? So the colleges group, that group of the three colleges coming together themselves, is really a principal-led group that's looking at the detailed operations between the three colleges. And I know that some of the college principals feel it's a good springboard for a potentially a different option to look at for the way the three colleges operate.
But just finally, you said you knew some of the principals thought that was a good springboard, but I'd specifically asked how they were specifically involved with the consultation and dialogue, how the Glasgow College Group were specifically involved as an entity in that discussion. So what is their input into it and how can they influence it?
So my understanding is that they are going to be very involved in the nature of this. Not only have they been involved all the way along with GCRB's review, but we will be engaging with that group as we look at these final options before we make a recommendation. We will make a recommendation with the involvement of the key players. Now, that might not be easy because actually there are different views, both in the GCRB board, amongst the principals, and with other stakeholders. But we need to get to a point by the end of this year where we're making a clear recommendation about how we move forward with the right kind of governance for the future.
So Glasgow MSPs should know before Christmas what the outcome of that is?
We should be engaging with all stakeholders, including Glasgow MSPs, yes.
Thank you.
We have a supplementary, if you don't mind, Bob Doris, from Willie Rennie on this subject as well, please.
Yeah, I'm intrigued by some of your language. It sounded like you're delegating responsibility for leading this reform to the Glasgow Regional Board. Tell me that's not the case. Are you leading this work or are they leading it?
So we are now leading this review of options. Yes.
Okay, fine.
Okay. Are you okay, Bob Doris, on that?
Yeah, that was really helpful clarification from Mr. Rennie. Thank you.
Great. We have a couple of sweep-up questions, if you don't mind. One from myself, and we've got one also from Graham Day. It goes back to some of the stuff we've heard, that we need to try and make sure we get coverage for our inquiry and budget scrutiny. Previous evidence explained about is around the COVID funding and that colleges are still continuing to deal with the COVID impacts as we're looking forward. So would you have expected that the funding to at least be carrying on for a bit longer than was perhaps, now we've had that cut off and it's not being sustained any further? I was looking for comments on that, given perhaps from yourself, Shona, first, if that's okay.
I mean, obviously, with a sector that's struggling to balance its books, additional funding would have been very helpful. That's sustained funding because a lot of the things have been embedded. So, for example, the mental health counsellors that were put in place in colleges, that was specific funding that was made available, not necessarily COVID, but mental health funding. And there's no clarity on the future of that. So that's just one aspect. I also think the way that digital has changed the way that colleges run, a lot of the COVID monies were used to assist with that, to hand out laptops and so on, or make sure there was data allowances for students. Those things, some of that have carried on as colleges have developed their offering post-COVID. So absolutely there are additional costs that are there that would be really helpful if we could have the funding to continue with that.
And is that sort of detailed and mapped out? Is it quite obvious that is there in the specifics? I'm talking around that data allowance, because that is, as you said, that's not just a one set cost to then get the investment.
The specifics around mental health and digital poverty were included in our submission to the spending review ahead of the May announcement, and it wouldn't surprise me if they feature in our draft budget submission, which is still going through our governance process at the moment.
So the £5 million investment for the digital for colleges and universities and community learning providers, so it's not just for yourselves, is there to address the current digital divide. But do you think that's enough?
No.
A yes or no answer's fine. That's good for concise. I like that. Does anyone else want to ask? Andrew, James, sorry, I'm getting...
Sorry, convener. So you were picking up there around additional funding that flowed into the system, but one of the points we might wish to make around the current year funding, and it's around learning loss, which members picked up earlier, is we have allowed colleges to claim additional credits this year from their core funding to ensure they're able to direct additional support to learners who have had their learning experience disrupted due to learning loss elsewhere in the system. That's not additional money, but it's making sure at the front end that learners who need additional support are able to get that, and that colleges are able to claim that against their credit targets from SFC.
And that goes back to some of the questions that we've got earlier on from lost learning, and the colleges were being expected to pick up the slack on that. Can we move to yourself now, Graeme Day, please?
Many thanks, Convener. 2 points of clarity from Karen Watt, hopefully. Karen, you indicated earlier that in determining the levels of funding that universities enjoy, you take account of the additional overheads, the cost base that they have. But do you also take account of their ability to generate income from other factors? I see you're nodding your head, so I take it that's a yes. Because you see where I'm getting at here, the colleges don't enjoy that opportunity. So the other point is around, if you were to arrive at a decision where you were going to ensure that the funding per student afforded colleges was the same as university, was like for like provision, can you give us a ballpark figure about what that would be worth to colleges if you did that?
Crumbs, not off the top of my head. My apologies. I wouldn't be able to give you that quickly at this point, no.
To us about that, because it would give us a sense of what difference it would make.
It's perhaps just worth saying, so we can do that, but for academic year 2022-23, the average level of SFC-funded place per place at universities was around £7,500. For colleges, it's around £5,000.
But I'm talking about specifically where there is like-for-like provision being provided. And so there would be a number attached to that, a multiplier to the 2,000.
What we could look at, if it's helpful, is looking at how many higher national students and yes, how many undergraduates, and provide the committee with some additional work on that. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Are you okay?
Yes, perfect. Thanks.
My goodness. Thank you very much. At the time, that's my goodness, was looking at the time there. I want to thank you all for your time today. That's the public part of today's meeting at an end. So we'll now consider our final agenda items in private. So thank you very much for coming along this morning. Thank you. I was expecting to...